Good morning and welcome to First Congregational United Church of Christ here in Ocala, Florida. We are an open and affirming church, meaning that no matter who you are, no matter where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. And although nobody's here in this room other than myself at the moment, when this pandemic is over, we will be back together in full force. This is the 50th video production that I will have conducted for this during this pandemic time. It hasn't been a full year, but we have created several other videos to go along with our ministries here at the church. Today's scripture lesson, I'm going to talk a little bit off the cuff here. Today's scripture lesson is from Mark's Gospel. Mark's Gospel is one of the three synoptic Gospels, S-Y-N-O-P-T-I-C, synoptic. And the three synoptic Gospels are Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Probably they were written Mark, Matthew, Luke, or Mark, Luke, Matthew. But in any event, the Gospels of Matthew and Luke draw an enormous amount of their material from Mark's Gospel. I find Mark's Gospel to be, in many ways, the most interesting of the three. The other two, Matthew and Luke, are longer. They have longer sermons, like, for example, the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew's Gospel, the Sermon on the Plain in Luke's Gospel. Luke has lots and lots of parables. But there are two or three things that interest me in particular about Mark's Gospel. First is the emphasis on healing. There are many of the healing episodes in Mark's Gospel. We're going to hear about one of them today, the healing of Peter's mother, the healing of the daughter of one of Israel's enemies, a Roman centurion, several others. In Matthew's Gospel, the emphasis seems to be on the connection between Christianity, the gospel of Christ, and its Jewish roots. Luke seems to be writing more for a cosmopolitan audience. And with Mark's Gospel, it's very important to recognize, as with all of the other Gospels, that we're not dealing with a history lesson. We're not dealing with a biography of Jesus. There is no definitive biography of Jesus. We know a few things about his life and his ministry and his values and so forth. But in terms of a history, even history as recorded in the day and time of Jesus, it's not a history. I oftentimes ask people, what are the first words of the Bible? And a lot of times people will say, in the beginning, and they go on with the first of the creation narratives. I think the most important words are testament. I don't like to use the word New Testament and Old Testament as if the New Testament were somehow fresher, more valid because it's newer. Certainly it was created fewer years ago than the Hebrew scriptures. I prefer the terms Hebrew scriptures and Christian scriptures. Bear that in mind whenever you're approaching the Gospels. It is not a history lesson. It is not a biography. The second thing about Mark's gospel that interests me is a single word, and that is immediately. Immediately he got up from this spot and went to another spot. Immediately he did this. Immediately he did that. You find that over and over and over in Mark's gospel. There's an urgency, a pressing forward, a movement in the direction of Jerusalem, finally. And to understand, it's difficult for us sometimes to understand the power of that word immediately. It doesn't really translate well from the original language. But you have to think of immediately as urgently. Gotta go now. Move. Okay? Now, about today's scripture lesson, we also need to understand a bit about the audience to whom Mark was writing his gospel. And the answer to that is probably to the Jewish church, the Christian church in Rome. And at the time that Mark's gospel was written, we're guessing somewhere between 50, 55, 60 years after his death and crucifixion and death, that the Christians in Rome were undergoing a terrible pogrom, terrible conflict with the Romans. Rome was going through a really bad time of its Caesars, C-A-E-S-A-R-S, I think that's how you spell it, with its Caesars, Nero, Caligula, others. Self-appointed men who claim to be, guess what? The Messiah, the anointed one of God. Well, the Christians come along and they have another view on who and what constitutes Messiahship. And in response, the Caesars, the powers in Rome, turn around and they begin to crucify them. As we probably know stories, vignettes about that, about being in the Colosseum at the hands of gladiators, being murdered, killed at the hands of wild animals, and so forth. So Mark was writing his gospel to a particular community of faith. He was not writing it for, say, the Jews who had converted to Christianity, who lived in and around, mainly around Jerusalem. He wasn't writing his gospel to that audience. He wasn't writing it for Luke's audience, Luke being, as I said, more cosmopolitan, appealing to cultures, societies, countries beyond Israel. Mark was writing his gospel to the church in Rome. And we have to bear that in mind because we have to do a great deal of translating in order to fully understand what's going on and not presume that, say, Mark was writing his gospel for all time. He wasn't. It was the decision of the Christian church many, many years later to canonize Matthew, Mark, Luke's, and John's Gospels and claim them to be authoritative within our faith. One other word I want to bring to your attention, and that is the word amazed. That's how it gets translated, has gotten translated for centuries. For example, in the sentence, and his opponents were amazed at what he said, or the disciples, they were amazed at something that Jesus said or did. Amazed is a very poor word. The word correctly translated is horrified. They were horrified at what he did. They were horrified at the things that he said. They were horrified at the positions he took in contrast and in opposition to his opponents, scribes, Pharisees, and so forth. I will be making that free translation to correct it. Well, let's ask the question, why did such an obvious word like horrified get translated as amazed? And the answer is that the translators over the years decided to put their own theological spin on what Jesus did and how others reacted to him. I think that they wanted to soften his effect, to say, oh, they were amazed at the glorious and wonderful things that he did, instead of horrified that he said some of the things that he did, because they knew full well that he'd gotten a deep well out of which he would have a great deal of trouble emerging. So, today's scripture lesson is from Mark's Gospel, the first chapter, beginning with the 21st verse. Jesus had just come into the area. We are introduced to John the Baptist. He calls his first disciples. Jesus and his disciples went to Capernaum. And when the Sabbath came, he entered the synagogue and taught. And they were horrified. This is one of those spots where what we have in English is they were astounded. They were horrified at his teaching, because he taught them as one having authority, not as the scribes. And just then there was in the synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth?" Interesting word, us, right there, when one person is talking. What do you suppose they're referring to, us? "Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are. You are the Holy One of God." But Jesus told him to shut up and said, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing the man, with a loud voice came out of him. And they were horrified. And they kept on asking themselves, "What is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." And at once, Jesus' fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. Friends, listen. God is still speaking, and we are still listening.
Wilt thou be made whole?
Sir, I have no man, when the water is troubled, to put me into the pool. But while I am coming, another steppeth down before me.
Rise. Take up thy bed and walk.
Thank you. It is the Sabbath day. It is not lawful for thee to carry thy bed.
He that made me whole, the same said unto me, take up thy bed and walk.
What man is that which saith unto thee, take up thy bed and walk?
The Gospel of Mark recounts Jesus' first act of public ministry as his preaching in the synagogue and to boot several times on several Sabbaths. Now, knowing what I know, I'd appraise this as somewhat naive. He broke every rule in the book, but as we know, he didn't care much about rules or care about religious protocols if religious protocols stood to impede larger, more important matters. To elaborate, we don't know if he were invited to speak in the synagogue, but he did, and he upped and started teaching and preaching. Second, he dragged along his own congregation, namely the disciples. We call that a booked audience or a loaded audience. Third, Jesus had not attended Hebrew seminary. Now, of course, we know that that doesn't matter. We read the end of the book, but the Hebrew leaders weren't thrilled and they weren't impressed. Fourth, he drew a larger crowd than the Hebrew authorities. And lastly, he healed a man whom they could not heal. On a scale of 1 to 10, I'd give him about a 4 with respect to tact. As the gospel accounts go to Jesus, tact usually involves evasion or downright lying. They would call it a breach of protocol. He would call their position about a breach of protocol as downright evasion or downright lying. Graciousness or kindness is quite another thing. But such was his MO in the Capernaum sermons, his blue period, let's call it that. Funny thing, however, we have absolutely no idea what he actually said in those sermons. But we do have a clear picture of how he handled conflict. Take note, the first account of Jesus as a prophet, a pastor, is a blueprint for conflict management gone completely wrong. According to Mark, everything in Jesus' life from that first sermon in Capernaum on to the end of his life involved some measure of conflict, whether an encounter with his enemies, with lies, or with an encounter with immature assumptions among his listeners. He was always challenging someone about something with a vigor, with an urgency. Style, call it. Jesus was a scrapper. Take a look at the Capernaum conflicts, two very important components. The first having to do with authority. Verse 22, accurately translated, states, and after he had finished preaching, the disciples were horrified, appalled with his teaching, because he spoke with authority and not as one of the scribes. Now, why do you think that his disciples were horrified? Well, that's an easy one. First thing Jesus does, he doesn't shift along. He doesn't go along playing the game, acting like a plebe, mumbling dreary, bland prayers, reading long psalms at length. No, Jesus, to their horror, stood and spoke with authority. Big trouble, really big trouble. And if you don't believe me, stick around for Good Friday. Now, why do you figure they had a bone to pick over Jesus' authority? Ask yourself the same question. Why do we have such a problem with authority? And I'll tell you why. Because we worship independence and we abhor being controlled by somebody else through authority. Shakespeare nutshelled the matter from King Lear. You have seen a farmer's dog bark at a beggar, and the beggar runs from the cur. There, you now see the great image of authority. Even a dog is obeyed in office. And this from Shakespeare's Measure for Measure. But man, proud man, dressed in a little brief authority, most ignorant of what he's assumed, his glassy essence, like an angry ape, plays such tricks before high heaven that even angels weep. Why do we have such a problem with authority? First, for so many people, authority swells heads, bestowing to some the privilege of shelving such ridiculous trivialities as, oh, say, courtesy, good manners, patience, tolerance, all those nuisances we'd sometimes rather forego. Anyway, and we would forego them, some of us, if someone would award us the privilege. But since, of course, we never have that problem, we fear and detest others who do. Second, we equate power with authority, a type of power befitting our purposes, our goals, our aims, our wants. Whereas Jesus exerted authority based on power they judged inflammatory, they craved power such as the scribes had, untouchable power. Jesus exerted another variety of power and authority. Power and authority, the species Mark offered those Roman Christians who were persecuted. For those Romans who faced death, their yearning may have been the same authority and power the disciples yearned for, but realistically, they knew that under the boot heel of Rome, they'd never have it. No, what they needed was another kind of authority, an authority that would help them endure even to the edge of death and beyond. Another part of this drama usually goes unnoticed. There, living in the temple where the men of the synagogue, you know what constitutes a synagogue? I'll tell you, any 10 Jewish men gathered together in one spot. You don't have to be in a house or in a sanctuary. 10 men gathered together. There among them was an 11th, a man with an unclean spirit. And this character was always hanging around when the temple, as it happens this time, when any 10 men got together, could be a different group of men, driving them crazy, interrupting, pressing them to the edges of their patience. Now, outsiders might find the notion of someone with an unclean spirit, that such a person would ever hang out in the temple, to be just absurd. But as a member of First Congregational United Church of Christ of Ocala, Florida, you must easily concede that this is not entirely out of the question. Even if some parishioners aren't evil in spirit, I'll tell you, I've had a few. None of them that I can think of at the moment, of course. None of you. I've had a few members who aren't necessarily unclean in spirit, but I'd go with weird in spirit. I wish I could tell you how many times when I invite someone to church, what is returned is, no way, I don't want to be around a bunch of hypocrites. They go to church and then they act just like the rest of us. I'll leave the logic of that argument to your own good graces, but one component of this statement warrants attention. The church is composed of people who sometimes have unclean spirits, who sin, or more ordinarily, they just act like knuckleheads. It's no laughing matter. But isn't that why we're here? To try to get a bead, a lasso, a harness on those parts of ourselves that we want to be better, to make our lives more vivid. At least when we're here, we propose to do something about unclean spirits, or at least weird spirits. At least most of us do. But then some people attend church simply to abuse its authority to support their own opinions. You've heard it. I know you have. I'm a Christian, therefore my opinion is correct, and everybody else, and maybe even you, are a jerk, or some variation on that. Look, that's the same improper use of authority as the man with the unclean spirit. You see, the man challenged Jesus to misuse his authority, challenging Jesus, saying, I know who you are. You are the Son of God, a statement implying, all right, go ahead, just use your higher authority. Beat me up, you, with all of your power. Go ahead, but you couldn't do it any other way. You couldn't do it mano a mano. So familiar. On the defense. Understandable. Choosing physical power, threatening power, sarcastic power, embarrassing power, logic power, reason power, any kind of power to get what we want, regardless, every option to weave kindness and patience into the equation. Preferring power over negotiation, power over even patience, dominating our children, controlling our mates with anger, maintaining our dignity, all and more, protecting our authority to stay on top. Perversion, defending our opinions with our religious beliefs, yo. Not much different at all. Saying that I'm a Christian, therefore I'm right and you're wrong. If you're not a Christian, that is an abuse of power. And tempting as it may have been to Jesus to summon the power of authority, Jesus ordered silence, quiet, refusing to implement his power, no less than yours or mine, when we choose to take it. No, even though abusing power was his for the taking, most certainly, it is just as available to you and me. He didn't bite. He could have used the authority of power. We can use the authority of power, but he didn't bite. He didn't abuse the authority of power. He offered the authority of compassion. The man with the unclean spirit was indeed affected, maybe infected, by circumstances beyond his control, maybe demons of his own design, but like so many of our own afflictions of the soul, his afflictions consumed him. So many of us assume a snide, spiteful attitude towards everyone else, figuring, I can be whatever I want because everyone else is out to get me, so go ahead, beat me, hurt me, make me write bad checks, it won't matter, do what you want. So go ahead, Jesus, with your almighty power, bring down your army of angels to destroy me, but minus your army of angels, power, solvency, prestige, mental health, and cool. Jesus, you couldn't do it any other way. But Jesus declares, shut up. Keep your temptations away. And get that evil spirit out of my face and out of yourself. And with that, the man gave a yell, and the evil spirit left him. Now you tell me, why did the evil spirit leave the man? Because of the authority of power? Or because of the authority of compassion? Controlling our spouses with threats of allegiance. Bossing our children to do their chores. To behave. To parrot our ambitions and our tastes. Reacting to others' insensitivity and rudeness with harsh words and slander. Confronting other people's power with comparable, but more often greater power. Or maybe in another way, something just as bad. Shrugging, flipping it off, rolling our eyes, and walking away. But drawing on compassion, that finest mark of our Christian ideals, perhaps our most corrupt and evil spirit is our opting for power over compassion. But we like the title Christian, but let trouble or harsh words or problems or ornery people enter the picture, and then you can go get your pen and paper and draw a picture of the way that we oftentimes cope, of the spirit we bank on, the authority of power. Just like the man with the unclean spirit. Now, you may take offense at everything that I've said about the possibility of people with unclean or weird spirits congregating a church or being a part of a church. You may be angry. You may wish I hadn't said it. I get it. Believe me, I get it. Or maybe I'm just talking about myself. And none of this applies to you. Jesus came into the temple, and he comes into our churches and our lives and our hearts, offering another way, another spirit, the authority of compassion. And the disciples never quite got over it. Our gospel writer says that they were horrified. I imagine that they envisioned Jesus actually using the meat cleaver method on the man instead of what he did in acts of compassion. Not until after Jesus died did they really catch on. It must have been some kind of rude awakening. No, it's more than a rude awakening. Do you think that the only person that got resurrected after Jesus' crucifixion was Jesus? Is that what you think? What about then? What about their resurrection into a ministry, a world of kindness and compassion? Jesus astounded, amazed them, horrified them, but encouraged them to use the authority of compassion, theirs for the asking, no less than his for the offering, no less than theirs for the embracing, no less than diminishing themselves to the authority of power. He came to comfort the Christians in Rome in their hour of need, saying, know that I am with you and that I understand and know that the way of compassion is the best and that the authority of compassion is God's very own authority and nothing, no one, not sword, not lion's jaws, not Caesar, nothing has greater authority in God's eyes, and no other authority will enable you to endure the peril and sword, life, or anything better than the authority of compassion. The authority of compassion offers life, even in the midst of death. So you choose. It's sometimes a terrible choice, one that will wrench your unclean spirit from your very bones. But still, it is a choice. The authority of power or the authority of compassion, yours, mine, daily, moment by moment. And so which shall you choose? What'll be the mark of your spirit? What will be the mark of God in your life? Amen.
Blessed be. more.